Hey everyone, today we're just going to focus on a single event, the Constitutional Convention of 1787. We're going to take this event and break it down into its most basic components, the who, what, when, where, why, and how, and discover how the Founding Fathers created the U.S. Constitution. Let's start with the what. What is the Constitutional Convention? Well, if you look up both words in the dictionary, here are the definitions that you'll find. A constitution, which we've already looked at more than once this year, is a group of established principles and procedures that a country is governed by. A convention is just a meeting of people who share a common interest. So, who were the people at the convention? 12 of the 13 states sent a total of 55 representatives, or delegates, to the convention. Rhode Island was the only state that didn't send anybody. They figured that if they didn't send anyone, then nothing could get done. But as we'll see, they'll be proved wrong. The 55 delegates who did show up were like a group of all-stars from the 13 states. All 55 of them played some sort of role in the American Revolution, whether they served in the Continental Congress or they fought during the war. 75% served in the Congress under the Articles of Confederation. Many of the delegates had more than one career. 35 were lawyers, and others were farmers and businessmen. 25 of the delegates owned slaves, and the average age was 44. One of the most important delegates at the convention was George Washington. He was the most famous, respected, and richest man in the United States. He decided to attend the convention so others would take it seriously. It's kind of like the cool kid at the party. If he's not going to be there, nobody wants to go. On the very first day, he was selected as the convention's presiding officer, or president. Not as well known, but probably just as important as Washington, is James Madison. While everybody else was standing around wondering what to do during the first days of the convention, Madison pulled out a plan of government that he had written days before. So he's kind of like that kid that always gets his homework done ahead of time. But Madison's plan served as the basis for the new Constitution. He also wrote down what everybody said for the next 3 months, and it's because of this we know what happened at the convention. So, it should be no surprise that when all this was over, James Madison was referred to as the father of the Constitution. Also present was Benjamin Franklin. He was the oldest delegate at the convention, and would die soon after. He was so weak, he had to be carried in every day in a sedan chair, and he was often found sleeping in the corner. But like Washington, his presence helped others take the convention seriously. Another name for the delegates at the convention is framer. A lot of people confuse the word framer with farmer, because as you can see, they look similar. But a framer's different. A framer is a builder, somebody who puts something together. So for example, the framers you see here are providing the framework of a house. The rest of the house will be built around what they've done. So when we talk about the framers of the Constitution, we're talking about the delegates who came up with the basic framework of the United States government, namely the three branches and how they'll work together. There are also some important people who were not at the convention. Neither Thomas Jefferson nor John Adams were able to attend because they were both out of the country. Jefferson was representing the United States in France, while John Adams was representing the United States in Great Britain. Choosing not to attend the convention was Patrick Henry. The man famous for his "Give me liberty or give me death" speech also famously said, "I smell a rat." He refused to attend the convention because he believed it was a danger to the power of the states. The Constitutional Convention was held in Philadelphia. Located in Pennsylvania, Philadelphia was the largest city in the United States at the time, with a population of over 40,000. The delegates met in the same building where the Declaration of Independence was signed 11 years before. The delegates gathered in Philadelphia during the summer of 1787. This turned out to be one of the hottest summers on record. And remember, there's no air conditioning, and nobody was wearing shorts yet. So why did the delegates meet in the first place, especially under conditions that were so uncomfortable? What was so important? Well, we spent a lot of time in class talking about the weaknesses of the Articles of Confederation, America's first constitution. We talked about its weak national government with no president and no court system, how Congress couldn't tax or raise an army. In fact, we saw that all the power had been given to the states. So all of the delegates who attended the convention in the summer of 1787 understood that if the country was going to move forward, it was time for some big changes. So how were the delegates able to bring about such big change? One of the first things all the delegates agreed upon was to keep their conversations private. Nobody was allowed to write home or discuss with anybody outside the convention hall what they were talking about. This rule of secrecy makes Madison's notes more important, because without them, we would still have no idea what was discussed over those 3 months. Under the Articles of Confederation, every state had equal power. So, the delegates who arrived in Philadelphia wanted to make sure that their state would be taken care of under the new system. This proved difficult when a conflict broke out between the large states and small states. This conflict was over how each state would be represented in a new Congress. Large states like Virginia wanted it one way, while small states like New Jersey wanted it another. What each state wanted is something we'll look at more closely in class. Another conflict broke out between the northern states and the southern states. This conflict centered around the counting of the slave population. Had nothing to do with the slaves themselves, just over how much power each state would have in Congress. Northern states like New York wanted it one way, southern states like South Carolina wanted it another. Again, we'll look at this more in class. In order for large and small states and northern and southern states to resolve their conflicts, they would have to compromise. So let's head back to the dictionary and see what that means. A compromise is an agreement, but in this sort of agreement, each side must give something up in order to get what it wants. If either side gets its way, it's not really a compromise. Both sides must make a sacrifice. So for example, the large states wanted one thing, and the small states wanted another. They found a way to meet in the middle, and the agreement or compromise they reached was called the Great Compromise. Also, the northern states, who wanted one thing, and the southern states, who wanted something else, also found a way to meet in the middle, and the compromise they reached is called the Three-Fifths Compromise. What each compromise said is something that will be dealt with more later. So why is any of this important? Well, let's look at it this way. For years, the colonies were ruled by a strict king and parliament, kind of like a strict parent. And nobody likes a strict parent, because that just leads to unhappy children. So in the American Revolution, we got rid of the strict parent. Now the states, or kids, were free and independent, and they could do whatever they want because there were no more parents around to tell them otherwise. But eventually, those kids are going to find themselves in trouble. And without anybody around to help, they're going to find it difficult to get out of the situations they put themselves in. So Super Nanny is brought in to show clueless and weak parents and crazy kids how to work together and build a successful family. And that's what the Constitutional Convention did. It got rid of the Articles of Confederation, which gave all the powers to the states, and instead created the U.S. Constitution, which showed the national government and the states how to work together successfully. How'd they do it? With an idea called federalism, the sharing of power between the national and state governments. Now, we've learned about federalism already this year. If you didn't learn it then, now's the time. Federalism is always on the star test, so if you're not going to learn it, I don't know, be sick that day or something, because that question will be there. So we've seen that a strong central government doesn't work. A strict king and parliament took away many of the rights of the colonists, which is why we fought the American Revolution. Going in the other direction didn't work too well either. When we gave the states all the powers under the Articles of Confederation, that also failed. But we finally struck a balance with the U.S. Constitution, giving power to both the national government and the states. So over time, the 13 separate individual states began to view themselves as one in the United States of America. How else did the framers achieve this balance between the national and state governments? Well, now would be a good time to go back and review these videos, the structure of the Constitution, and the principles of the Constitution.
See you next time, and thanks for listening.